So the first thing you need to do to survive the music industry business is make sure your gear is up to date and isn't susceptible to corrupting after you've just finished shooting a 50-minute episode of the podcast. That's exactly what just happened. Took the hard drive out of the recorder and it just completely died and corrupted. So no video for the entire episode. Thankfully, I was recording the audio on a separate channel. That is now going to play with some sort of static screensaver type thing. I hope you enjoyed the episode. It was an unfortunate technical mishap. Hopefully we're back on track, technically speaking, next week.
Hey, it's Janek Gwizdala. It's the Janek Gwizdala podcast. We're talking about surviving the music business, the music industry. I don't know if surviving is the right word. Maybe coping, having coping mechanisms for that. But I guess at the end of the day, if this is what you do for a living, if music is how you generate an income and survive, maybe it is surviving the music industry, the music business in its most basic form. Very quickly before we get to that, and very sort of related, I would say, because basically the way I'm going to look at things are through the eyes of being a small business. That's essentially what I do as a musician these days. And I'm going to talk about how it changed and a couple of little things that came up along the way that have actually only been pointed out to me very recently, and sort of highlighted as to... Anyway, we're going to get to it all. I'm sitting here in front of a massive stack of books, huge influx of inventory. That's something I'm dealing with lately for the very first time when it comes to books. We can talk a little bit about that as well, the actual logistics of how to get these things in and then out of the door to you good folks of the bass world all around the world. But for our holiday season here, we are Monday, December 18th. This is going out. We're having a little last minute, end of the year, end of 2023 holiday season sale at the store. All of the digital books, all of the ebooks are on sale. You can get 30% off right now, automatically added at checkout. You don't need a discount code or anything. So that's all the ebooks, all the bundles. They are all on a 30% sale. All of the courses, all of the base courses that I've been adding to the JanekGwizdala.com, having done this huge shift with all the bass studio stuff, all of those courses are 25% off. That's the learning by ear. That's the transcription vault. That's the live archive. That's all of those base courses. They're all linked in the description of the video or the show notes, or you can just go to JanekGwizdala.com and check it all out for yourself. There's a ton of stuff going on there, and it's all very, very obvious. Banner across the top of the website telling you what's going on, and all of the discounts are added automatically at checkout. And the physical books continue to fly out of here. I'm continuing to sign them and mail them up and put them in padded mailers and send them all over the world. So that's still happening. And as you can see, we've actually got some stock now. So many of these were sold out for so long. Pentatonics, our most popular book, that was sold out. Giant Steps was never in stock in the first place. That's now back. We've got sight reading, first time. We've got more chordal harmony. We've got some 10-minute manuals. We've got altered. We've got 251s, looping, warm-up, chordal harmony 2, better stuff, good stuff. Even a few practice to performance. Iconic Lines is sold out right now. That's not coming back into stock until just after Christmas. But let's get into it. Let's get into the surviving the music industry. What I'm describing right now, the sales and the products and these things I'm talking about working on and creating to get out there into the world are where I find myself surviving in the music industry in 2023. Obviously, that started very differently for me. And it all started from a live music standpoint. I guess recorded music as well, because I wanted to be a studio musician. And in the early days, I was fortunate enough to do a bunch of that and sort of cut my teeth in the studio, both in the UK before I left and then in New York, where I spent a large portion of my, I spent a decade, some of my most growing years as a musician. And spent a lot of time in the studio, but primarily to say it came from a standpoint of playing the bass. That's how I survived the music industry. That's how I always intended to survive the music industry and to thrive in it and to, you know, hopefully add to, contribute to society and add to the music scene and create a scene and create music and do all those things. It has since changed. That hasn't completely gone away. I'm amazing to be like filming this and recording this today because I'm actually getting on a plane a few hours after this goes out, flying to New York for a quick one day record date. Going to cut a new album with Manuel Valera and who I play a lot with, actually with a bunch of different people, but mostly with Steve Smith in Vital Information, and a drummer I've never played with before. Super excited to play with Mark Whitfield Jr. So we're cutting a trio record, old school, one day trio, live in the room, no bullshit, probably no overdubs, no fixes, no repairs, no more than two takes on anything. You have really had to practice the music. So that is just a testament to the fact that while I might be sitting here amongst physical books that I've written over the years and talking about discounts and sales and that part of my business, I am very fortunate to still have that other side cranking away, and the phone still rings or the text still pings, and I get those calls to go play music all over the world. This one happens to be in a recording studio, happens to be in New York, and it's a really quick one. It's a red eye out tonight. It's an all-day recording session. I land in the morning, I think around 9. It's an all-day recording session, probably wrap it up around 6 or 7, go to the hotel for a few hours and take the 6 a.m. flight back so I can pick up my daughter from daycare. It's one of those super out, fast out and back jobbies. The one thing I wanted to talk about briefly was something that was brought up recently. If you haven't seen it, go check out the SBL interview that I did. I did it back in September, but it came out a couple of weeks ago on the main SBL channel. And it's over, it's, I think it's 2.25 hours long. So it's, you know, get a cup of coffee or, you know, get cozy because it's not a short one. But one of the things we talked about, one of the things Scott asked me about was my first album was Mystery to Me, that is coming up for its 20th anniversary in 2024, which is kind of crazy to me that it's been that long and I've managed to keep making records through that whole time. We got into the weeds on it. We got into the nitty gritty talking about, yeah, so how did you do it? And I was young at that point. I was 25. And it was my, you know, I've talked about it before. It wasn't the first record I'd made, but it was the first sort of major production. And it was definitely the first production that I knew I was going to release. Once I'd got to that level and got that level of musician and that level of studio and engineer and production and artwork and all that stuff, I was pretty much set that I was going to release it no matter what, even though I'd made 4 or 5 failed attempts beforehand. I still reserved the right to be like, okay, maybe I won't put it out if it's horrible, but I'd gotten to a place finally where I was like, I think I can do this, and it's coming out. So we did this record. Scott asked me a bunch of questions about it, and we started getting into the weeds about, yeah, okay, so how much did it cost? You know, let's talk about, you know, the beans here, like how much did I spend on it? And it was around $10,000 in total, and Scott was kind of pressing me for like, where did that money come from? Did I throw it all on credit cards? And I was like, there's no way at 25 I even had access to a $10,000 line of credit. So while some parts of it were, of course, went on a credit card, and I had maybe a little bit of cash floating around from a recent gig, I borrowed some money from my mom, and I pieced it together. And what I said, just sort of a throwaway thing in the interview, and I've talked about this a bit before on my own channel, was like, yeah, and you know, I never recouped that money. That money was just gone. And I sort of maybe said it in the tone of voice that was like, ah, not a waste of money, because I loved that record and I loved what we achieved and the experience that gave me. But there was definitely a sense, I think, in my voice when I answered the question of like, yeah, well, you know, not seeing that money ever again, you know, like, that's gone. And Scott made a good point of, he's like, well, yes and no. Like, maybe actually that was like, maybe like, I'm just going to reach for a random book here on my pile. Okay, Bass Player's Guide to Altered Chords and Scales. Maybe that album rather, and that investment of $10,000 has something to do with the success or not, maybe, but with the success of a book like this, and the fact that people know who I am, the fact that people trust me to deliver information about music, especially in an educational sense, in these books, for instance, and through some of my videos online. And he made the point of like, well, actually that $10,000 was probably a great investment and you've made it back way more times than perhaps you realized, because it fed into so many things you did that came after. It gave me some sort of validity in the scene, some sort of, I don't know what the word is, like some sort of status, maybe, or standing. I don't know. It put me on the map a little bit. Maybe I was in the corner of, like, I don't know, like Eritrea or something, on a little sandy, you know, I wasn't like in the center of Paris or London on a map. Like, I wasn't like on the map. I wasn't in the center of New York. I was on a map somewhere. But instead of being completely obscure and unknown, it did help somewhat to start to establish myself as a musician, both as a musician and also as a band leader, which, to Scott's point, sort of has probably paid off many times over in the future. So all of that to say, it sort of doesn't matter what you're doing or how much it's costing or what you might think of something at the time. There's probably a much bigger picture that isn't apparent and that isn't even in focus at the time. There's probably a much bigger picture coming along somewhere in the future where you can look back and say, oh, I see that did something good for me, even if you don't think so at the time. So I'm always a big fan of encouraging people to go and do stuff, just to say yes to stuff. There's like, I wouldn't know Tosin Abasi, for instance, or of course, Morgan Agron, if I hadn't just said yes on a whim when Morgan contacted me, like completely out of the blue. This is over, it's maybe 11 or 12 years ago, I think this happened. He just came to LA. He was making a bit of a documentary or something. It was a film crew following him around, and he decided to call some musicians that he liked. He's an incredible Swedish drummer, just an incredible drummer who happens to be from Sweden, who I've since become friends with, and we made a record together aside from the project that I played on for him. But just saying yes to that one thing, there was no money involved. It was just basically on faith, and I didn't know who he was. He knew who I was, but we had never met, so we'd never played together. I wasn't aware of Animals as Leaders at the time. This is like 2011, 2012. I definitely wasn't listening to that kind of music at that time. There was another incredible musician called Daedalus, who was like an electronic musician who was doing live sampling, and it just ended up becoming this thing that was way bigger and ended up creating relationships. Like, I've now known Tosin for over a decade. I've known, of course, Morgan. I didn't stay in touch with Daedalus that much, although I seem to remember we've either texted or Instagram messaged back and forth a couple of times over the years when I was on social media. I believe part of that project did get released, a trio portion of it with me and Morgan and Daedalus. And there's also an album sitting in the can of me and Tosin Abasi and Morgan Agron as well that I don't think it ever saw the light of day. I don't think that ever came out, but what an amazing experience. A couple, 2-3 days in the studio with all those guys hanging out. Met Javier Reyes, obviously one of the other members of Animals at the time, or still is, rather. So just saying yes to that had a real sort of knock-on effect of knowing some great musicians for a really long time. And something, even I at the time, I've always tried to be open-minded and say yes to things. And you, of course, have to pick your moments when there's no money involved. You know, you're rolling the dice a little bit, and sometimes there's no money involved, and it's like people that are just, that you know, maybe you haven't met before, but you know are just like undeniably you want to be in the same room as that person. This was one of those things where I didn't know Tosin, and I didn't know Morgan, I didn't know Dayla, so I didn't have that like, oh, these are just my heroes, so I'll do it no matter what. It was really just, okay, let's roll the dice, let's take a bunch of gear to the studio, and let's see what happens. And what happened was fantastic music, amazing people, insane experience, and something that has stayed with me, you know, regardless of what I might do with Morgan or Tosin or Dayla, any of those other people, regardless of how we might work together at some point, what stayed with me was the musical experience. And that all adds to the bigger picture that I'm talking about in terms of surviving the music industry. So it's not always about money, even though that is a really necessary component, of course, when you have to survive. It's sometimes about saying yes to the things that don't pay anything at all, and just having some faith that they will potentially pay off far bigger than you could ever imagine down the line. And, you know, suppose it hadn't. Suppose, like, this is so weird to say because these are obviously incredible musicians, but let's just say that I'd said yes to this thing I didn't know about, and Tosin and Morgan happened to be like, yeah, whatever. Terrible music, some people I wasn't really into, and what did I lose? I would have lost 2 days of my life and never had to think about it again. So I know 2 days sometimes feels like, oh man, that's a lot of time to commit for no return. But it's really, it's quite, the time thing seems quite insignificant compared to the payoff when you look back on it. And you can always say, like I just did, man, it wouldn't have been that bad if it had sucked, because I'd have just moved right on to the next thing. I think it's harder when you have some experiences that suck and you have some maybe multiple experiences like that. It's harder to pull the trigger again in the future because you may be a little more jaded. But yeah, so many things. And it's crazy because there are some things that I've said yes to that are completely unknown that now I'm thinking about. And it's because, and even those things, the things that sort of sucked, I met other people through them that paid off 1,000 times more. And I'm still like very good friends with those people and work with them from time to time. And we talk about those moments of like, how the hell did we end up on this bullshit together? But man, I'm glad we did, because we met and great. We've had so many years together that have been super positive. So even on the ones that suck, there could be someone around that you're just like, oh man, really good that I met that person, you know? I got to say, like, let's look at my relationship with Bob Reynolds, for instance, who I've been playing music with now for over 25 years, because we met in the middle of 1998 and started playing together almost immediately. I mean, of course, we were sort of destined to meet at some point at Berkeley, because the cats on that level, there wasn't, you know, although there were like 3,000 students there, I think, at the time, there weren't that many on that level who could really play. So it was a small pool of people. I was in a scholarship ensemble. So it was like we were sort of destined to cross paths at some point. But the way we did, and the first time we played together, was also just on a whim. It was like, hey, do you want to come and do this thing which has nothing to do with the school, no extra credit? You know, I didn't have to pay for it or anything. It was just like a little sort of jam session thing, which I could easily have said, you know, I think I'm going to go and get lunch instead. It was like a lunch hour or something. And I could easily have said, man, I got to eat. And I didn't. And I went there and it was me and Hal Crook and Bob Reynolds just playing trio for an hour. And there it is. Here we are over 25 years later, still doing it. Major, major important relationship in my life, both musical and personal, of course, at this point. And yeah, I think I'm glad I have those moments. I'm glad I have moments on both sides, some things that sort of sucked and some things that were amazing, and that I can look back on it and be like, oh, all of these sort of paid off no matter how they started. And some you knew from the beginning they were going to start, like with Bob, and we were just going to be friends forever. And some you were like, oh, shit, man, I don't know what's going on here, but let's see. Let's also not forget the money side of things. Let's also not forget the reality of how I then navigated, and how one has to navigate the next years. You know, it's not all rainbows and roses, that's for sure. And unfortunately, like, I have to be so brutally honest and upfront with anyone listening. Unfortunately, all I can do is tell you about my experience, which in so many of my formative years is from a very different time now. And of course it's from a different time because it was 2 decades ago or something, but I'm talking about business-wise, it's such a different landscape. And I'm not about to say, oh, it was so much better then, or it was just different, and it has changed, and a lot of people have adapted, and those who haven't are struggling or have just disappeared. And you may or may not be a fan of what the scene is now or what is out there. I'm a fan of some of it. I'm not a fan of some of it also. You know, I don't sit here at home just being grumpy that it's not the way it was 20 years ago, or it's not the way it was when I was even younger and aspiring to be in it. Because life moves on, you know, the greatest of all time are the greatest of all time for a little while, and then somebody else comes along and replaces them. And I think that feels like it's true for the business side of things as well. You know, if 25 years ago you'd have told me, oh, by the way, like a major part of your income is going to be through selling books, I'd have been like, you're out of your mind. The Berkeley bookstore sells books. I don't fucking sell books. Ah, quick pause for the cause here. Rehydration, very important. So yeah, that was, I could never have, sort of foreseen that, you know, maybe I could have thought, oh, maybe I'll do an instructional VHS at some point, or DVD, or whatever it would have been, the media. And maybe there'll be a book in it, and I'll do a book for Chuck Schur or Alfred or Hudson Music or something. Never did I think I would write. I mean, how many books were I? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 14, 15, 16, 17. I've got three out of stock. I've written 21. 21 books. That's insane. You know, if you look at the generation above me, you know, the people I aspired to be, like the Victor Wootons, the John Patitucci's, the Marcus Millers, Stanley Clarke's, like that generation of people who are sort of 60 to late 70s, like that kind of age group. I don't know how many. I know John's written a bunch of books, but I know it's not 21. You know, that's totally insane. And I'm by no means saying I'm in any way better. I want to highlight how different it is generationally. And perhaps the book thing is even something that's out of date for a younger person now. And it will be something else by the time, if you are 20 years old listening to this, by the time you're 45, it'll be something completely different. It's just served me really well to move with what's going on in my own way. And I haven't moved in a sense of TikTok and Instagram and all those things. And I haven't moved in a sense of, well, in the sense of covers, inverted commas, covers, which is ironic because I'm playing like other people's music lately on my YouTube channel. We'll talk about that in a second because that's been very interesting. But they're not fucking covers. Just remember that. We're gonna rant about that in a second. But that is a big thing, right? There's a massive cross-section of the internet, of YouTube especially, of just content creators who sort of go around in that circle. They create content, companies sponsor them. There's not really so much like practical experience happening in that cycle, but the cycle's being kept alive because companies want to sell gear and musicians want to be musicians, and that's just one lane to be able to do that. To charge for reviews or to, you know, to make content that's sponsored by companies. That's a whole other lane. We should do like several episodes of the podcast on that, and also interview some people as well and get some different takes. And it'd be nice to have a longer discussion about that whole thing. But that is a lane. And as much as I say I have tried to adapt, and I of course have adapted, I haven't done it to the extent that somebody 10 or 20 years younger than me is doing right now. So in that sense, that change is happening all the time. I just at some point got to the certain place where this is my capacity. This, my threshold has been met, and I'm not willing to do the new thing as much as the next person, because that's not me being honest. That would just be me trying to, like, what do they call it? Trend jacking or something. It'd just be me trying to hop on the bandwagon. So really delicate balance of trying to stay honest and true to yourself, plus progressing and not being here like the grumpy old man, like get off my lawn, refusing to admit that electricity has been invented. I'd hate to end my life as one of those people. You know, it'd be nice to be somewhat relevant at the end. But I have a passion for something that's becoming less and less relevant, which is writing and recording music. It sounds like a weird statement to me, because of course plenty of people make records and music gets listened to, but the art of it, I feel like, is on the downtrend right now. I'm really hoping it comes back. I'm hoping there's a big shift back towards writing and recording and sort of artist driven art, you know. Let's see. I'm going to be here doing it. I love doing it. A quick side note here. I was fortunate enough to get some multi-tracks, some board mixes from the Pizza Express when we played there about a month ago. I was also at Peggy Skylight in Nottingham, hooked me up with some multi-tracks. Those ones I haven't listened to yet, but the ones at the Pizza Express I just listened to two nights ago. The sound was exceptional, like live album exceptional. I posted a clip on my channel yesterday. You can check that out on the main channel. And a little shady because that was the first song of the first night of the tour with no rehearsal. It was a little sketchy sharing that because we weren't dialed in at all. Musically, we can function on a very high level as an ensemble and as improvisers. But when it came to the accuracy, shall we say, of the notes of the compositions, we were sort of, and myself included, I'm not like throwing the guys under the bus, and I think maybe Cliff knew it better than all three of us, which is kind of crazy. But there were moments for all of us, I think, on the gig where we were slightly uncertain. Oh, is this a 4-bar phrase or a 6-bar phrase? Like little details that you don't really get locked in until you've either rehearsed a lot or you've played a lot of nights on the road. And the first night was when we had the 4-camera shoot going on. So I have amazing video footage of a night that was sort of less than optimal in terms of the accuracy of the performance, even though there were great moments. And I'm going to post more clips rather than entire songs from that night. The second night, we felt super relaxed. Didn't have to sound check. Cliff and I had been in the studio all day, so we were loose and we'd played. And we'd even played some of the tunes, from the show. So yeah, it was a totally different experience the second night, and way more accurate, and I think just a better show. So I'm really considering putting together 40 to 43 minutes of music, some songs from that, and putting out a live record. I think that would be a really fun way to start 2024 before we get into new music and new recording and new tours and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, just a little aside there to let you know that's sort of percolating in the background. And I finally, it's just been an insane month since I got back from that. I just didn't have time, and finally getting to all of that, and very happy. Board mixes are always a bit of a lottery, and Marcos, the house engineer over there, this great Brazilian cat, did just an outstanding job. Live, we felt amazing. Sound was beautiful in the club, monitors, front of house was amazing, and he just captured the stuff and put up really nice mics and really did a great job miking the band and just captured this thing in a multi-track session that I was really blown away by. So can't wait to share some of that with you. Hopefully early 2024 we'll have an entire live album of the music from the new record, from Nightwatch. And happy to say we played a couple of things on the gig that I wasn't, that I had never played before live. I played how am I gonna forget the name of my own tune. I'm gonna open Spotify and look it up. Oh my god, it was the most popular tune on the Union. And all I've got is the original working title in my head. What a knucklehead. How can I not remember that? Anyway, we played that one. It's like the tune people have covered the most of mine on YouTube. I guess I got to look it up on my phone because Spotify's not open on the computer. Let's see here. How... It's just amazing to me that even like I'm thinking like, oh, I'll just remember it even before I get to the Light Years. Oh my God. Thank you. Jesus. It's probably like the most played tune I have on Spotify. Anyway, I'd never played that live before, and we did it with a trio and it was really fun. It worked well as a trio with Tom with the left hand comping some bass and some synth stuff. Really worked well, and I was kind of happy with the way the second night the performance was. So hopefully that will make it on the live record as well. I know that was a popular tune out there. You guys and girls responded well to that one. So that's just a little aside. That's yet another, I guess, another lane, another tentacle of the business, and it's one. I just put out Nightwatch, of course. It came out in October, and it was a big project. We flew to Argentina. If you've been following along, you already know the story. If you're new to the podcast, it was a big recording project. My new trio with Tom Cawley and Cliff Arman. We flew down to Argentina. We recorded for 4 days straight with Juan Pablo Alcaro. We played a concert down there to try and warm up the music. And for me, it was incredibly successful, emotionally successful, musically successful, financially. I did the pre-sale like I'd done before on One Way Out last year in 2022, and the album, it broke even. But it's another thing. I have to go back to the SBL interview and think about what Scott said. It's yet another thing of like, yeah, it broke even, it didn't make me any money, and it might never make me any money directly, but it's a massive investment in the overall picture of what it is. I hate using the word brand because that feels really corporate, but whatever word you want to use, for yourself, for your business, for your music, for your art. We have to pick a word. We could use brand, we could use image, whatever you want to call it. Doing things like that are a very important part, at least they have been for me so far, a really important part of my sort of public-facing, forward-facing image. And those kind of projects really help awareness, spreading the word. They bring in new fans, new audience members, potential buyers of the books. You know, people are like, oh man, never heard of this cat before, and let's check out what he's doing, like the music maybe, and oh shit, he's got some books. Oh man, I always wanted to learn how to sight read, for instance. Well shit, I wrote a book about sight reading, Bass Player's Guide to Sight Reading. So those kind of things are really worth thinking about, even if you know, or even if you're worried, for instance. There you go. There's a thing we all suffer from at some point in music, I'm guessing. I know I have over the years a lot, is worry, anxiety. You know, you worry about, oh man, is this going to pay off? Is this going to be worth it? Should I do this? The answer is almost always yes. You know, a lot of things have got to go badly wrong for it to be a loss, you know, even if you lose money on it, or even if it doesn't do what you hoped it would do right away. I'm pretty sure that if the internet stays in existence, and if things like Spotify stay there as an archive of art, essentially, or if there's some way I can leave a visible location for my music and for what I've made out there, I'm pretty sure that in 200-400 years, I'm not saying this will be on the level of the person I'm about to reference, but it will be a similar kind of thing of like, we can look back several hundred years and look at Mozart and Beethoven and Brahms and Tchaikovsky and Shostakovich, and we can look back 50 years, 60, 70 years, look at Miles Davis and John Coltrane, who are no longer with us, and all those, you know, it doesn't matter who you love, you can look back at Animals as Leaders, you can look back at Dream Theater, you can look back at Bob Dylan, whoever it is, you'll be able to look back and I, and you, if you're listening and you record music, or anyone out there who is passionate about this, will be able to leave something behind that will do something for someone. Like, that's the hope, you know, is that it does something for someone. Over the years, I've had many thousands of messages, and I'm just thinking of a few recently, which are very, really powerful. Like, I'm talking about people who were considering taking their own lives and have written me messages about, and then I listened to this song, or I've started listening to music, something. And in some way that made some sort of connection to be like, oh, there's a reason to stick around. You know, there's a reason to be here. You know, and some people's reason to be around is to appreciate. Some people's reason to be around is to create. Like, we all have our different purpose. Sometimes it takes us a really long time to figure out what that purpose is, or what we love, or which direction we might want to go in. But I think the process of writing and recording and putting things out there into the world, I know that it helps. And it's the question of, like, I don't care if it helps a million people, or if it helps one person, or if it impacts one, you know, it doesn't matter to me. Like, I'm not doing this for fame or for notoriety. It's doing it because I love doing it so much. And I know that it also has there's a byproduct of it having an impact on certain people's lives that make it an absolute no brainer to say yes most of the time to doing things. So yeah, worth thinking about. I think about this a lot. This is on my mind very often, you know, especially, you know, I take this very seriously. You know, I have fun doing it, and it's a big, big laugh, and I get to spend time with my friends and do all this cool stuff. But I'm also very fucking serious about the way I do it. That's just for me. I'm not saying you should be or you have to be. I'm just letting you know that's how I approach it. And speaking to that thing of like finding new fans and getting messages from people, that has sort of definitely jumped in frequency lately because of all of these songs of other people's that I'm choosing to play on my channel. I have this series, in case you are not aware, it's called Could I Play Bass With? And I'm not sure, actually, I'm going to look here. go to the channel and see, go into playlists and see how many I've put up. I've sort of lost count. It's not that many, but I've definitely, I don't know how many are up there, but there are a bunch. Playlists. Could I play bass with? Oh, there are 8 up there right now. So I've done them with, let's see. I did one with Noah, with Journey, with Isaac Delgado, with Pliny, with John Mayer, with Noah, with Animals as Leaders, with Dirty Loops. And the latest one I put up is with a band called Intervals. Aaron Marshall, I believe, is the guitar player, band leader, or band name owner. I checked him out. I think that he's like the only actual, like, he owns the band, and there are sort of side men, like freelance musicians who play on tour. I don't know any of them personally. I know of Jacob Umansky, who plays bass. I know he played bass on the song. It's called 5HTP, was the song that I chose to play of theirs. And it's been a really interesting exercise for me. Again, so I ranted a little bit earlier that these are not covers, and they're not. I'm not like rearranging the song and re-recording it all and like totally transforming it. Like, to me, that's a cover. Like, when you actually go and play the whole thing, like, as a, with a band, like redo it, you know. In a sense, I'm redoing it because this is not a transcription project. Really important to make the differentiation here is that I'm by no means going and transcribing the exact bass part and then just playing it back. What I'm doing is using this AI thing called Lalal, Lalal.ai. There's another one called Moises that I know is very popular. Lalal did sponsor my channel once for an ad that I put up there, and I'm actually using their product. They're not sponsoring the videos or anything. We have no partnership since that once, that one one ad they bought on my channel, but I'm actually using their product, and I extract the bass, so you're able to take the bass out. I had some messages like, oh, because I talk about transcription and don't slow things down and do everything in real time and all that stuff. Some people were saying like, well, what the fuck are you using Lalal for, man? Like, the John Mayer tune is only 4 chords or something. I added some like, oh, okay. Yeah, I'm not using Lalal to learn the part. I'm using it to take the part out. Take, in that case of the John Mayer tune, take Sean Hurley's part out so I can play my own part as I would have in the studio had I been the bass player on the session. And that's the exercise. It's an exercise at the end of the day. That's how I've always done it. I haven't always, of course, had access to this AI thing where I could extract the bass. I've just jammed along to records my whole life. And that was a side of my practice routine, a side of my process that I really wanted to share with people. And the response has been amazing. People are finding out about me and about my playing because they were fans of some of the music I was playing and playing along to, especially the Animals as Leaders things. That bought that one tune, The Woven Web, I think bought like, I don't know, 100 new subscribers in a day or something, which is a lot of, that's a high number for me right out the gate just for one little 4-minute video. My channel doesn't do those kind of numbers. It is another element. The YouTube channel is another element of surviving the music industry, the music business. It's the only place, aside from my mailing list, my newsletter, my blog at Substack, which is something I've always had, and of course this podcast. YouTube is sort of as close as I get to social media and to having like an open conversation with the community, with my audience. So it's a massive part of letting people know what's going on. I think the podcast probably does the best job of that because I talk obviously for longer and in more depth about things and let you know about tour dates and projects and books and sales and all that kind of stuff through the podcast. But yeah, the response to these things has been shockingly really positive. I had no idea what was going to happen. It's yet another thing. Maybe the biggest part of surviving the music business to me is like throwing as many things at the wall as possible and seeing what sticks, you know, and having the conviction to just keep coming up with stuff, or having the willpower rather to keep working on stuff. I think that's maybe if I have somebody asked me in an interview not that long ago, like, hey, if what is your superpower? You know, it's like a pretty standard interview question sometimes. And if I were to have a superpower, if I would consider, if I would call something that I do a superpower, it would be, it's not a superpower at all, of course, but if I did, it would be that I have the willpower to keep doing it. And that comes from, obviously, because I love doing it. There's no way around that. And when you really love the work, like I really, really love the work. It's the difference between like somebody who can really play and then somebody who's like, you know, US Open golf champion or the Masters champion like 8 times or something. It's like, I think someone like Tiger Woods really likes to do the work, you know. He's a total nerd and he loves it. Roger Federer loves the practice. Rafael Nadal loves the practice. That's why they're multiple Grand Slam winners. And, you know, Roger won Wimbledon 1,000 times or whatever it was, you know. It's like, and then you've got some people who are amazing players that never really do anything with what they have. And it's because they're like, oh yeah, I don't really dig the practice. You know, I don't jump out of bed and think, whoa, I'm out of here. Let me get to a tennis court. Let me get to a golf course or a driving range. Let me get to the practice room and pick up the bass. And I am. Like, that's the, so maybe that's my superpower, is that I fucking love doing the work. And I can do endless amounts of work without any goal, without any, not purpose, because there is purpose in doing the work. I know that everything I work on leads to something better. Even if it's just in myself with growth and becoming a better musician. But if there's no, I can do untold quantities of work even without a specific goal. And that is something I've been conscious of for a long time and something I've tried to lean into more and more and more, and sort of like, oh, I'm not around for that long. I don't have that much long left in the grand scheme of things. You know, when you think about dinosaurs and how long shit has been around, I really have like a few seconds left. So I have been leaning into that, you know, for want of a better phrase, superpower way more. And especially now it's like the need for it is amplified and the lack of time is magnified. Like I have to like get from 0 to 100 in a very short space of time in terms of my productivity, because maybe I only have 20 minutes or there's only like on the weekend is a 90 minute window in the middle of the day where my daughter naps. And if I don't have anything else, which I normally do, if I don't have anything else to do and I can get to practice, I have to get into the mood very, very quickly. You know, there's very little foreplay here when it comes to practice. Like, bam, here's your time. Let's start making the most of it and making it happen. So, although as I talk here about surviving the music business, although I may not be talking about like, well, do this and you will make these number of dollars, it's not that kind of discussion. It's more about how you find faith in the fact that the number of dollars will come at some point. And I think underneath it all, you have to be super committed to the work and committed to yourself and understand your limitations when it comes to how many responsibilities you can take on outside of your music, if music is what you do full time. That's something I've had to learn in a big way, being married and having a child and the house and the dog and the cat and all of these other things that go on besides the bass and besides music. Got to be aware of those and work just as hard to balance them all. And you're going to fuck up at some point. You're going to get it wrong. I do. On a too regular basis, unfortunately, I fall behind or I get in a rut or, you know, I get into trouble time-wise or something. You know, this, it's a constant adjustment that I have to make. But it's probably, you know, those few non-financial focused elements of life in music are probably the few things that are the most important elements of your success or potential failure. I think that's maybe a good place to leave it, Because that's a lot to think about. It's a lot for me to think about. Like, I'd be sitting here thinking about this stuff, and then I'd take a pause and be like, okay, let's walk around, let's play a frame of pool, let's go do this hanging or something like that, let's whatever, some planking, some squats, anything, just to take a pause and sort of go back on the last few thoughts and dig a little bit deeper into them. So maybe that's a good place to leave this here. It's the holidays. Happy holidays, however you celebrate, wherever you celebrate. I hope it is a celebration. And if it's not a celebration right now, think about a time when it was, and try and build some confidence into the fact. It's not a fact that it is possible to get back to that. You know, I've been going through some ups and downs lately where I felt quite distraught and sort of maybe without direction a little bit, and I really had to look back to, like, oh, you know what, I've been here before, I've experienced this before, but I know I've had good times before, and I know how I got to those good times, and I know how I was able to sort of improve my process as I go, and pick up on little cues and not try and force the issue and sort of eke out the positivity that is so important with being happy. And with being happy obviously comes, I think, so much more productivity, and with that will come success on all levels. You know, emotional, financial, you name it, musical, artistic. So yeah, if there's one thing I want to leave you with, is like, there are massive amounts of hope no matter where you're at on the scale. And I've been pretty low on the scale in recent times. And despite that, I'm still able to think, like, you know what, it's going to be okay. And definitely moving in the right direction, which I know everyone is capable of. So happy holidays. Yeah, I'll be back. I think Christmas is on a Sunday. I don't think I'm going to be taping the podcast on the 25th. It's also my wife's birthday that day. It's a busy old day, and it's one of the few times in the year where we're doing some family stuff and running around LA, and it's going to be a bit of a busy weekend. So I think we'll probably pick it up a couple of weeks from now. Don't forget, the sale is going to run through New Year's Eve, and I'll definitely be back with a podcast before New Year's Eve, because I have a couple of things that I'm letting go. Again, I'm in that, like, strip things down and make some space type of mood, and there are a couple of basses are going out the door, and what else? Oh, a few pedals as well that I never thought I'd get rid of, but I had to be super honest, do that Marie Kondo thing and be like, it might bring me joy, yeah, okay, but I haven't used it in 6 or 7 years. I'm like, you know what, this is just taking up space. And I've had so many things come into my life recently, amazing, beautiful pieces of gear. The Caveman Audio, the BC1, the compressor, beautiful. That's one thing. I have a couple of things that I can't talk about because the drop dates aren't here yet. But I'm actually going to be one of the few people making a video about a pedal when it comes out on the day. I don't think I've really done that before that much. So I'm sort of excited about that. Can't tell you what it is. So basically, there's a ton of stuff coming in the house, so some stuff has to go out. And to that end, I'll be posting it on the website. And Los Angeles Craigslist in general, and maybe on Reverb, I don't know, but I'll make an announcement of that before the end of the year, before New Year's. And our sale, all those discounts I mentioned at janekgwizdala.com will run through midnight on New Year's Eve, and that's it. Then we'll start 2024 brand new. I've got three major projects about to be greenlit and get going in January. So psyched about that. Psyched to tell you about them as well. And that'll be it. Big master reset January 1st. Boom, off we go. That's it. Happy holidays, people. Love you guys. Thanks for making it this far in the video. If you did, don't forget to smash the thumbs up. Subscribe to the channel. That always helps. We are going to make it to 100,000 subscribers on YouTube and beyond. And it'll help bring bigger guests to the channel as well. Definitely a lot of people I want to sit down and talk to and bring you those conversations. So, yeah, that's it. Take it easy. Have a great holiday. Speak to you very soon.